Hello students, I'm Komal Malhotra. We are learning about human memory. In the first lecture, we learnt about nature of memory, information processing approach by Atkinson and Schifferin, and levels of processing approach by Craik and Lockhart. We then learnt about components of short-term memory, types of long-term memory, and classification of long-term memory. Today, we are covering the second part of the chapter, human memory. This is divided into two parts. The first part shall cover knowledge, representation, and organization in memory. This will include understanding of concepts, categories, and schemas, the hierarchical network model of Alan Collins, and the dual coding hypothesis. The second part of this section will help us understand memory as a constructive process as against memory as a reproductive process. Let us now examine knowledge, representation, and organization in memory. Since long-term memory holds a very large amount of information which is put to use with amazing efficiency, it would be very useful to know how our memory system organizes its content so that the right information is available at the right moment. Many ideas relating to organization of the content of long-term memory have resulted from experiments that have employed semantic retrieval tasks. There cannot be any error in recalling the contents of semantic memory. But people may take variable lengths of time in answering questions, which require semantic judgment. For example, answering the question, "Are birds animals?" will require more time than answering, "Do birds fly?" A. Concepts, categories, and schemas. The most important and basic unit of representation of knowledge in long-term memory is a concept. Concepts are mental categories for objects and events which are similar to each other in one or more ways. Concepts, once formed, get organized in categories. A category itself is a concept, but it also functions to organize similarities among other concepts based on common features. For example, the word mango is a category because different varieties of mangoes can be subsumed within it, and it is also a concept within the category of fruit. Concepts may also get organized in schemas. Schemas are mental frameworks which represent our knowledge and assumptions about the world. For example, a schema of a drawing room will have different things like a sofa set, a center table, paintings, etc., which are found in a drawing room. Thus, categories and schemas are the first level at which concepts are organized. Higher level organization. In the year 1969, Alan Collins and Ross Quillian suggested that knowledge in long-term memory is organized hierarchically and assumes a network structure. Elements of this structure are called nodes. Nodes are concepts, while connections between nodes are labeled relationships, which indicate category membership or concept attributes. This led to the concept of cognitive economy, which means maximum and efficient use of the capacity of long-term memory with minimum redundancy. Example: people take longer to verify that a canary is an animal compared to canary is a bird, because bird is an immediate superordinate category in which canary is subsumed, while animal is a superordinate category which is more distant and remote from the concept canary. According to this hierarchical network model, we can store all knowledge at a certain level that applies to all the members of a category without having to repeat that information at the lower levels in the hierarchy. Dual coding hypothesis. Originally proposed by Pavio, according to this hypothesis, concrete nouns and information related to concrete objects are encoded and stored in the form of images, while information related to abstract concepts assume a verbal and a descriptive code. For example, if you are asked to describe a bird, The first thing that happens is that an image of a bird is generated, and based on this image, you describe a bird. But on the other hand, the meanings of concepts like truth or honesty will not have such accompanying images. Thus, any information encoded verbally and visually will be recalled with greater ease. Now we deal with memory as a constructive process. Ebbinghaus and his followers emphasized that memory primarily consists of reproduction of stored material. It is a passive occurrence of learnt material that has been stored. This was challenged by Bartlett, who contended that memory is an active process and all that we have stored undergoes continuous change and modification. Information committed to our memory system cannot remain in isolation from other cognitive processes. Therefore, memory is a constructive and not a reproductive process. Bartlett used the method of serial reproduction in which the participants of his experiments recalled the memory materials repeatedly at varying time intervals. While engaging in serial reproduction of learned materials, his participants committed a wide variety of errors. These included altering of text, glossing of unnecessary details, elaboration of the main theme, and transformation of the material to look more coherent and rational. Memory, therefore, is an active process of construction where information is encoded and stored in terms of a person's understanding and within his or her previous knowledge and expectations, that is, schemas. We shall now learn about nature of forgetting, causes of forgetting, and enhancing memory. Nature of forgetting. The first systematic attempt to understand the nature of forgetting was made by Hermann Ebbinghaus. He observed that the course of forgetting follows a pattern. The rate of forgetting is maximum in the first 9 hours, particularly during the first hour. After that, the rate slows down and not much is forgotten, even after many days. There is always a sharp drop in memory, and thereafter the decline is very gradual. Causes of forgetting. Forgetting due to trace decay, the disuse theory. This theory assumes that memory leads to modification in the central nervous system. These memory changes in the brain are called memory traces. When these are not used for a long time, they fade. The trace theory of forgetting has been proved inadequate. If forgetting takes place due to decay of memory traces with disuse, then people going to sleep after memorizing should forget more compared to those who remain awake. Forgetting due to interference. The interference theory suggests that forgetting is due to interference between various informations that the memory store contains. This theory assumes that learning and memorizing involve forming of associations between items, and once acquired, these associations remain intact in the memory. People keep acquiring these associations, which rest independently without any mutual conflict. Interference takes place during the time of retrieval, when various sets of associations compete with each other for retrieval. Interference can be proactive or retroactive. Proactive or forward-moving interference means what you have learnt earlier interferes with the recall of your subsequent learning. For example, you know English and you find it difficult to learn French. Retroactive or backward-moving interference refers to difficulty in recalling what you have learnt earlier because of learning a new material. Example, you cannot recall English equivalents of French words that you are currently learning. Forgetting due to retrieval failure. This theory states that forgetting can occur because at the time of recall, either the retrieval cues are absent or they are inappropriate. Retrieval cues are aids which help us in recovering information stored in the memory. Category names and the physical context in which a person learns also serve as retrieval cues. Enhancing memory. There are a number of strategies for enhancing memory. Four of these are discussed below. First, mnemonics. Mnemonics involve use of images or self-induced organization of learned information to enhance memory. Mnemonics using images. Mnemonics using images require a creation of vivid and interacting images of and around the material you wish to remember. The two prominent mnemonic devices which make use of images are the keyword method and the method of loci. We first discuss the keyword method. Suppose you want to learn words of any foreign language. In keyword method, an English word that sounds similar to the word of a foreign language is identified. This word functions as the keyword. For example, if you want to remember the Spanish word pato, which means duck, you may choose pot as the keyword and then evoke images of keyword and the target word. For instance, a duck in a pot full of water. The method of loci. This method requires that you first visualize objects or places that you know well in a specific sequence, imagine the objects you want to remember, and associate them one by one to the physical locations. For example, suppose you want to remember bread, eggs, tomatoes, and soap on your way to the market. You may visualize a loaf of bread and eggs placed in your kitchen, tomatoes kept on a table, and soap in the bathroom. Mnemonics using organization. Organization refers to imposing certain order on the material you want to remember. The two techniques are chunking and the first letter technique. In chunking, several smaller units are combined to form large chunks. For chunking, it is important to discover some organization principles which can link smaller units. The first letter technique. In this technique, the first letter of each word is picked up and arranged to form another word or a sentence. For example, colors of a rainbow are remembered in this way, vibgyor. Deep level processing. As discussed earlier, Craik and Lockhart have demonstrated that processing information in terms of meaning it conveys leads to better memory. Deep processing involves asking as many questions related to the information as possible, considering its meaning and examining its relationships to the facts you already know. We now come to minimizing interference. We have learned earlier that maximum interference is caused when very similar materials are learned in a sequence. Arranging your study in such a way that you do not learn similar subjects one after the other is one such way. If this is not possible, distribute your learning by giving yourself intermittent rest periods while studying to minimize interference. Retrieval clues. While learning something, identifying retrieval clues inherent to your study and linking parts of the study material to these clues helps in enhancing memory. Cues are easier to remember compared to the entire content. The links have created between cues and the content facilitate the retrieval process. With this, we conclude the last section of the chapter, Human Memory. To summarize, we first learnt about nature of memory, stage model of memory, and levels of processing. We then moved on to components of short-term memory, types of long-term memory, and classification of long-term memory. This was followed by understanding organization of knowledge in memory and memory as a constructive process. We then moved on to nature and causes of forgetting, as well as memory enhancing techniques. Thank you.